And I'll introduce myself first. I'm the one that has been doing the majority of the email correspondence along with Millie Harris when we originally thought we were going to combine two projects. Because of the complications involved in doing that, we've detached ourselves from one another, but we are supporting each other's efforts. So it will just be as we discussed it at the very beginning, having you all come and do what you do. And it will not be linked to our research efforts. That'll be a separate project. So I'm Lori McCullough, and I'm one of three supervisors in the social work department at Nationwide Children's Hospital. And my primary, among my primary responsibilities is for the social workers at the primary care centers. And the primary care centers are venues that it would make the most sense to have your support through Encompass at. They would be very much like a primary care home, and that's how they're set up, and that seems to be the pattern for these sorts of programs. And so we felt like it would be a really good match to meet the needs of the families that get their care there.
And I'm Jeanette Foster. I'm the director of our social work department and the medical interpreter, so I have responsibility for both at Children's Hospital. And I've been working with Lori and with you all on this for, this is year two now, yeah?
Yes.
So we are beyond excited that you're ready to kind of come and start. So we think you have a lot of value to bring, so I think that's all I want to say about it.
This isn't about me, it's about y'all.
And did they all get a copy then of the agenda?
What you're going to tell, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So go ahead and take a look at that, and that's going to be an overview of what we were thinking would be important to talk about tonight. We are very open and expect that you're going to have some questions for us. We also know that some of you, how many of you have done this Encompass in other settings with other hospitals or places, and this is not the first time that you have been a volunteer through Encompass?
Okay. So we figured we would have a lot to learn from you about what you've already done. Mm-hmm. We have things we want to make sure we talk about, but you may already be thinking the way we're thinking, so there may not be as much as we think to share with you on that end. We also, before Lori gets started, I wanted to say we looked at your volunteer handbook, and so on this handout where we kind of looked through it and thought, okay, what's specific to us do we want to talk about that relates to your handbook? So where we have those page numbers there, that just is like a crosswalk to your own handbook.
So when we think in terms of sort of preparing you for your volunteer work over at Westside, we are thinking that you are bringing some experience with you. So we may ask you some questions related to, you know, what do you think about this or that? And that's because we're trying to glean from you what you already have experienced. And attached to that experience are going to be questions that you have. Because in your mind, you see how it all has worked. We don't get to have that picture in our mind. And so we're going to learn from you as far as what were some of the maybe roadblocks that you hit or places where you had some questions or concerns, and you think we're probably going to need a little guidance here as we embark on working at Westside. So, does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So why don't we get started? First of all, the dress code. In your MOU, how many of you, do you have a copy of the MOU with you? That's okay.
Yeah, it's okay.
It's fine. We do.
Awesome.
We've got the MOU, and then we also have the student observation form, and that was a form that those of you who are going to be working were to review and to sign. Do you have that with you? I've got my packet of stuff. So some of the things that we'll cover are also included on that student observation form, and although we know that you are not coming as student observers, our legal tweaked that, and they, here it is, made it more applicable to your role. So when it talks about dress, we've been a little more casual in the way that we put it on the site for the site training. And that is, we're okay with you wearing jeans. We really want you to be approachable for the families. And we think that in that particular setting, if you want to wear, I wouldn't have holes in your jeans. And I wouldn't wear shorts when it gets like it was today. But long, you know, neat jeans, I think is completely fine. And I think it will make families feel more comfortable with you.
Is bedazzling okay?
Maybe a little bit. Is that consistent with other places you've been?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
Good. And you'll be comfortable. So closed-toed shoes, though, that's one we kind of held on to just for safety issues. That's the most appropriate in the healthcare setting. So, any questions about that? Okay. And then we looked at your general volunteer script, and we really liked it. We felt like it really worked well for our setting. So, in review of the consent form that you specifically mentioned, you do not provide legal, medical, or other professional advice, and in that we assume social work advice as well. That's consistent with your experience in other places, correct?
Okay. So because you're in an environment there where families are used to also having social workers, we just wanted to make sure that if you would just kind of add that specifically when you do your normal spiel, that you don't provide legal, medical, social work, or other professional advice. So just kind of adding that so that they get, we talk to families about some of these same issues, so we're trying to create a distinction there in their minds.
And so, obviously, with the work that you do, you're linking them with the appropriate organizations. And you will have, you'll be located at the clinic, so when needed, and we're going to talk about this a little further into our meeting, you will have the opportunity, if you need to refer back to the social worker. So there will be a social worker on site. You'll be working from 5 to 7, so we'll have our evening social worker there. Her name's London Haji. H-A-J-I. And she will be available to you if needed, and we'll just kind of talk about, really the meat of our meeting is talking about when it's appropriate to reach out to that social worker. You'll also have clinical leads on, and I just have to find her name. The clinical lead for Tuesday will be Kim Harold, and she has been a part of this process. So she's familiar.
Nursing clinical.
Nursing, I'm sorry. Yeah. And so she's the one that kind of, is this the appropriate word or not? Is the choreographer of the flow of the clinic? Kind of where folks go, what folks do, how things run. And so in that sense, that's an important person for you all to know. On Monday night, there is another clinical lead. And then if it looks like you're going to be working on Wednesday, I will get that information for you. And I can find her name. I will find her name for you, but I have it here among all my papers. So I will make sure you have that before we walk out. And if I forget, let me know. And so Kim Harold is going to update the other clinical lead on what you're doing, why you're there, all of that. So you will have those folks to reach out to. When we looked, number three, when we looked at your needs assessment script, we really, really liked that as well. We think that you know, you guys have really put a lot of thought and experience into your volunteer handbook, and much of what you have here works perfectly in our setting. We definitely support your giving them specific permission not to answer anything that makes them uncomfortable. We just really love that in your guide, and think that's important for families to know that. Did you have anything you wanted to add to that? And then we took a look at your screening form on page 26. And there were just a couple of things that we wanted to bring out from that. One is differences in whether the questions are to parents as proxy for the children or for parents themselves. So when you think about your previous experience, how much experience did you have working just directly with the parents? You know, I know you had adult patients that probably didn't have minors involved, but when you worked with families, did you work directly with the children, with the minors, or was it primarily the parents?
I don't think that really any of our sites we've had interaction with families together.
Okay. Primarily only
been adults coming in.
And is it adults or is it parents of kids?
I mean, they'll have children.
Patients or
Yeah, and they'll mention, like, oh, I have kids and things.
So even at primary one, that does some pediatrics, you've just pretty much been focused on the parents, the adults.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So when you're asking those screening questions, like about access to mental health services, are the parents clear that you're asking as it relates to them, the adult access to mental health services, or are you asking for both the adults and for the kids?
I've always kind of just asked for the person I'm talking to.
Okay.
Unless they specifically bring it up in respect, like my child needs this or that.
And certainly families are going to bring up what they
want
to bring up in the moment.
So tell us a little bit more about that. So unless they bring it up. So if the parent does say, I don't have, but my kid, I can't get him in, what do you guys typically do around a mental health issue, for example?
I can't say I've ever done anything in regards to mental health. But just as an example, I worked with someone who needed clothing specifically for their children.
Okay.
So the need, the resource was for the child, but you were dealing with the parent.
Correct.
Yeah. So in our setting, because it's a pediatric setting, it may require a little more intentional communication with the family. To make sure that it stays on track with the parents. And that's really what our goal is. The needs of the child should be addressed pretty thoroughly in the clinic with the physician, the nurse, and the social worker. As far as concrete needs that that family may need, that would be direct interaction with the parent. I think because we're in a pediatric setting, it would be really helpful for you at the outset of your interview to be very specific about that, because families can become confused because they're at Children's Hospital and they're there for an appointment with their child. What you are working with them to uncover are the needs that the parent has. These questions are specifically about you, the parent, and making that clear at the outset. Does that make sense? That does not mean that the parent may not come out and say something related to the child and maybe even the child's care, and we'll talk about what to do with that when that happens. But I think that making it clear at the outset that this is about the parent, these are concrete needs that you want to be available to help, give them some guidance on and link them to resources would be a good way to start this. Any questions about that or any thoughts about that?
It makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
It's not something we really had to deal with before.
And that'll keep you in the territory that you know.
Mm-hmm.
And that you're very good at. And again, we have support if other things come up, and we'll be talking about that. Number five, when in thinking about escalating concerns to clinical staff, the staff in the primary care, based on your experience, whether that's at Primary One or some of the other organizations I know that your team has worked with, what are some things you believe you would reach out to the social worker for if they would come up during your time with the families?
I
Okay, abuse.
Maybe substance abuse.
Okay.
Domestic violence is something that comes to mind.
Okay.
And have these types of things come up for you already?
No.
Okay.
No.
Okay.
I think just with the way our screening form is structured, we don't tend to ask questions towards those areas. So and we've, in trainings in the past, we definitely made volunteers kind of aware of, you know, these are potential issues that might come up, but I can't say that we've ever, at least to my knowledge, really had to deal with the case.
Okay.
I think one time I did an informal consultation where someone just requested, like, counseling resources. But like that, it wasn't like specific resources like of like rehab or anything like that. So it was just like basic counseling, and so we were, I was able to find those on our database.
Okay.
But it wasn't like anything more extensive.
Okay.
You must do a pretty good job guiding the discussion.
Yeah.
So that they understand kind of what your track is. Yeah.
And we assumed you did because we know that you. All have been working for a while with Encompass, and so that's good to be able to avoid some of those more clinical questions that may take you places that you wouldn't want to go in your role. However, sometimes even with the best guided assessment, things will pop out. Have you ever had anything pop out?
Yeah. I don't know, like just kind of like psychological, like they can't really answer the questions very well, they're not really with it. Like just kind of some concerning things I've heard. And it was just like very hard to communicate with in that situation. I didn't really know what to do.
So how did you handle it?
I was like trying to, because she didn't really have like an email address or like a way to get in contact with her, so it was like very hard. So I was like, had to get her physical address in order to send her resource packet to her. So I literally mailed it, but
okay.
I didn't feel like I was able to have like the kind of impact that I wanted to, because I didn't know what to do.
Okay. So when we're looking at families and situations that might warrant reaching out to the clinical social worker, we're thinking of exactly some of the things that you talked about. We're looking at concern about abuse or neglect of patient, and we're hoping, and I use the term patient because client, patient, but the pediatric patient. We're looking at those sorts of things. Mental health concerns with the child. Our hope is that many of these things would have been covered during the clinical assessment and addressed perhaps before they even get to you all. And any other thing that may either present risk to the child, because we're very much focused on the child, but sometimes there are concerns that occur with a parent that can result in some significant risk to the child. It's one thing to get a notice that they may be shutting off your utilities, a parent getting that kind of a notice. It's another thing for it to be, 15 degrees that night, and you know that all of the utilities have already been shut off and the family cannot identify a place to go. There you have risk to the child. You also have episodes that could have a direct impact on the child's treatment. Like I was just in there with the physician and they prescribed medication, but I have no idea how I'm going to get the medication. And it's something that they really need to pick up that day, next day. And so those are things that can present a more urgent risk for that child, and those would be the sorts of things that you would be reaching out to the social worker for. And the two social workers at Westside, one is London and the other one is Laura Harden. Now she